Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. Dear brothers and sisters, we continue today talking about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a teenager. The years he spent with Abu Talib, his uncle, and Fatima bint Asad, the wife of Abu Talib. At that time, his cousins Ali and Ja'far, may Allah be pleased with them, they were not born yet, because Ja'far was born when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 22 years of age, and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was born when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 32 years of age. But we know Abu Talib had many kids, many children. One of them is Aqil, who is almost the age of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, he had many. Abu Talib had many daughters. The care Abu Talib and Fatima bint Asad provided to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is exceptional. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that Fatima bint Asad, who happened to be his fourth mother, you remember his first mother is Amina, his natural mother, his biological mother. We have Halima Sa'diya, his nursing mother, and we have Baraka, his babysitter, who Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam called later on my mother after my mother. Also, Fatima bint Asad was like his mother, and she treated him the best after Abu Talib. And he spent good time in the family, with the family of Abu Talib. As a matter of fact, they treated him royally. They would not eat. All the children will sit down and wait till Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes, till they start eating. And they have noticed that whenever Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is there, the food would be enough for everyone. When he's absent, the kids would fight for the food and all of them leave very hungry. So there was a lot of blessing from the presence of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the house of Abu Talib. And we know Abu Talib took excellent care of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was always next to him. And when he wanted to go up north with a trip, رحلت الشتاء والصيف, this is the صيف, the summer trip up north, he took Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his first journey. And he was a young kid, 12 years of age, and we know that he reached up north till the southern Syria nowadays, in a small city called Basra or Bosra, Askisham. There, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as a young kid, was sitting under a tree, and the priest, the Christian priest, Bahira, advised Abu Talib for the fear, because the news was widespread, the people are expecting a prophet. So they were worried about the Romans who ruled that area at that time, to harm the kid. So he was advised, Abu Talib was advised by Bahira to take him back to his city, Mecca. And Abu Talib took his advice seriously and he took him back to Mecca. After that, and at the age, almost 14 years of age, something bad happened. We call it Harb al-Fijar, the sacrilegious war. That time, two big branches of Arabia, Qais Aylan and Rabi'ah and Quraysh, they had a dispute and some serious problems, ended up in a war in the Ashhur al-Hurum. That's why called Harb al-Fijar, or sacrilegious war. And we know that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not participate in any of the fighting. He was protecting his uncles with a shield, but he wasn't part of the events. And the battle ended with the victory of Quraysh and Kinana over Qais Aylan. Not too long after that, something very important happened. We call it Hilf al-Fudul. It's a pact or the treaty of al-Fudul, where at that time was a lot of injustice and mistreatment for the foreigners, the poor, the needy, the women, the slaves, and you name it. And nobody would stand beside them to take their rights. There were no lawyers, no courts to go to. And most of the time, the one who is oppressed has to swallow it and go home and ask God for compensation. And one of those guys, his name, Al-Asi ibn Wa'il al-Sahmi. Al-Asi ibn Wa'il was one of the great chieftain of Quraysh. He was the caliber of Al-Walid ibn Mughira, Amr ibn Hisham, and Utbah and Shaybah ibn Rabi'ah. Those were the old guards who are guarding the Jahiliyyah. And we know that those who mistreated and bullied the Muslims, the early Muslims, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in all his stay in Mecca for 13 years from the time he became a prophet. And we know Al-Asi ibn Wa'il al-Sahmi, though he was rich and famous, but he was stingy, and he would not pay back his debt towards some of the merchants and so on, or the business deal he would make. And we know of two incidents, one of them which happened when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 15 years of age. And we know that a man from Arabia, from a tribe called Zubayd, so we call him Az-Zubaydi. This man, Az-Zubaydi, had a transaction with Al-Asi ibn Wa'il al-Sahmi. But Al-Asi ibn Wa'il did not pay him back his money. And every time that poor guy comes to him and tell him, I want my money, I had to provide my family, I had to pay my overhead expense and so on, he would tell him, come next year or come later on. And he did that many, many times till he gave up and he asked the help of Quraysh. So he went to Al-Ahlaf from Bani Abdiddar and Makhzum and Jumah and Sahm, Bani Sahm. So all of them, they let him down and they told him, just beat it, you'll get nothing and go home. But there is good people in Quraysh. Those were Hilf al-Mutayyabin from Bani Hashim and al-Muttalib and Asad ibn Abdi Uzza and Zahra ibn Kilab and Taym ibn Murra. Those Hilf al-Mutayyabin, when they heard Az-Zubaydi and he went up to the mountain of Abu Qubays, the highest ground next to, in the vicinity of Mecca, and he hollered with all his voice, threatening that he will spread that dealing of Quraysh with the people from Arabia, and that, you know, will damage their reputation and their credibility, and will affect their credit with the people. And one person took notice of that. And that person was Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib, the oldest or one of the oldest, eldest uncles of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib said, how come nobody is helping that poor guy? So he gathered the people from those tribes, Banu Hashim, Banu Muttalib, Asad ibn Abdi Uzza, and Zahra ibn Kilab, and Taym ibn Murra. This is Hilf al-Mutayyabin. Those are the good people. Mutayyabin means the perfumed people, the clean people. And they went to Al-Asi ibn Wa'il al-Sahmi, and they, by force, took from him the merchandise he took from the Zubaydi, the Arabi, and took him back his rights and let him go home. After that, they gathered in the house of Abdullah ibn Jud'an from Bani Taym, At-Taymi, and they signed a treaty. They signed a covenant that no person who is oppressed from Quraysh or outside Quraysh who would have a grievance or has been mistreated, he cannot be like that. He got to get support and help, and we are going to support him till he gets his right back. So this is what we call Hilf al-Fudul. And guess who witnessed that treaty or that pact, Hilf al-Fudul, in the house of Abdullah ibn Jud'an al-Taymi, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was a young kid, 15 years of age. Well, he was a teenager. He's a young man. Let's call him young man. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so much happy to see this agreement. It resonated with himself, because you know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Halima said, كان مفطورا على العدل مجبولا على حب المشاركة والفضل. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his makeup, the way he's built, to be fair and just to everyone, and to love fairness and justice to the maximum. And he lived that life of fairness and justice. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, later on, he reminisced on that gathering when he was a boy, when he was a lad, when he was a teenager at age 15. He reminisced on that event in the house of, or the mansion of Abdullah ibn Jud'an al-Taymi. He said, لقد شهدت صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, لقد شهدت في دار عبد الله بن جدعان حلفا ما أحب لي ما أحب أن لي به حمر النعم ولو أدى في الإسلام لأجبت. Which means, I have witnessed and I have attended and witnessed a gathering in the house of Abdullah ibn Jud'an, where a treaty was signed to establish justice. For attending that meeting, I would not change it or replace it or compensate for it, even if you give me everything in this world. And humrun na'am means the best of the camels, which is a nuq al-humr, which is like every camel worth a lot. So if you give him all those camels, he would not agree to change, or at least not to be there, because he loved to see justice being served. He loved to see people being treated fairly and rightly. And he said, if today the pagans of Quraysh, the Jahili of Quraysh, if they come to me with this kind of treaty to establish justice, I would shake hands with them. I would answer it. You see, he's so much keen on the issue of justice. And that leads us to the issue of the ideals. The ideals. You know, the moral values, the highest of those moral values, we call them ideals. You hear this many times from philosophers, from presidents, when they talk about the West, United States, they say this is our ideal, like liberty, like equality, like democracy. All of these are ideals. So if we want to find, even universities, they have some ideals, they call them motto, like Harvard, truth. And I want you to pick up the Ivy League universities and see what the motto of every university. They choose the best or the ideal things they are looking for. So if we ask ourselves this question, what is the ideals of Islam, which Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought? Of course, you read the Quran, you read the Sunnah, the Hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you find many indications which answer, or many ayat and many ahadith which answer this question. Number one, compassion, love, care, sympathy, empathy. All of these are ideals, and the highest ideal of Islam. How do we know? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Allah said, we have sent Muhammad a mercy and compassion and love and care and well-being of all humanity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 99 names and attributes. Which ones we use every day with every time we mention the word God? Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, the merciful, the compassionate. So this is the highest ideal. Al-Quran al-Kareem, a book of mercy and compassion. The message of Islam is the message of love, mercy, and compassion. Also, what's the ideal of Islam? Truth. You find telling the truth is uncompromised ideal and principle in Islam. The whole universe was established on truth. The word truth, al-haq, one of the attributes and names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And justice. The justice is something uncompromised in Islam. Fairness. And you find this in one ayah. In the Quran al-Kareem, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. Truth and justice. And more than that, one of the ideals of Islam is al-ihsan, which is a higher level of justice. When you serve justice, Islam tells you to be kind and to be generous and to forgive and forget. This is the level of ihsan. Even if somebody kills somebody and justice has been served and he deserved to be paying whatever money for the family and so on, al-ihsan tells you to forgive him and let him go. And we see this in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordering us, inna allaha يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ. بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ. Also, one of the ideals of Islam, which we read in the Quran, that all mankind are dignified. All the children of Adam are dignified. Believers and non-believers, as long as it is a human being. We read this in Surah Al-Isra, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we dignified and honored the children of Adam. This is one of the ideals of Islam, which goes across the board to all humanity, and also goes beyond humanity, to all the creation of God, including the environment and so on. All of them are honored and dignified. And of course, one of the ideals of Islam, that all humanity is one family. We came from the same father and mother, and our father is made out of dust. This will encourage us to be humble and down to earth, the earth which we are made from. So no arrogance, no pride, no viciousness, no malice, no hatred, no greed. We are all brothers and sisters. We should be very keen on treating each other kindly and nicely. One of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-khalqu 'iyalullah." The creation, all humanity is God's children. عيال. الخلق عيال الله. And the best among you who is the best to God's children. We don't like to use the children in our deen, not to mix it with the sonship and so on, because we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses these words just to make it close to our minds and so on. الخلق عيال الله فأحبكم إلى الله أحسنكم لعياله. The best among you in the sight of God, the ones who is the best in serving humanity. So beside that, Islam has solved many of the problems which humanity suffered for thousands of years after Islam. If we are coming from one family, our father is Adam and our mother is Eve, and all of us brothers and sisters and cousins. So why we fight if we are different in color? And here Islam comes strong against racism and tells you 1,400 years ago, not only 60 years ago, that the black is not better than the white, and the white is not better than the black. And the best among you is the most God-fearing, the most righteous person. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. This is the only criteria. If you want to be better, it's not the color of your skin. It's how good you are in society, how much helpful to your family and to your relatives and to your neighbors and to your society. This is the criteria, who is best. Also, we know we grow up into countries and nationalities, and here Islam 1,400 years ago said nobody is better than nobody. The Arab is not better than non-Arab, and the non-Arab is not better than the Arabs. All of them are equal. And the best among you in the sight of God, the best to everyone. Race and nationality, it hurt humanity so much over the thousands of years. The gender, males and females. Historically, females been hurt or been abused, and the male chauvinism all over the globe for thousands of years. Islam 1,400 years ago told us that women and men are twins. الرِّجَالُ النِّسَاءُ شَقَائِقُ الرِّجَالِ. They're twins. And in the Quran we say, بَعْضُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. Even they tell you, we are so much connected. Who is the woman you're talking about? Your mother? Are you better than your mother? Nobody would say that. Okay, then why all this prejudice against women? Because a woman, she is either a mother or a grandmother or an aunt or a sister or your daughter. And no male, he would say, that those are worse than me as a male. So Islam from 1,400 years ago in the Quran, in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said that men and women are equal, been treated equally in the obligations, in the takalif, in the reward, in the hereafter. So no, there is no differentiation. So even deen, we know there's many religions on earth. Islam never badmouthed any one of them, as long as they believe in God and they believe in the Creator and they don't hurt each other and so on. And we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that the Christian, the Jews, and the other religions would worship other things. All of them one day will come in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will tell him the truth. And in many of the other ayahs tell you that this is not important. What's important is فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. Do good. Compete. Instead of fighting, you're wrong, I'm right, I'm going to heaven, you are going to hell. This is not your wishful thinking. Even the Muslim, in the Quran we read, when they heard the Jews and Christians say, we are in heaven, you are in hell, and so on, all this childish stuff, the Quran came and said, لَيْسَ بِأَمَانِيِّكُمْ وَلَا أَمَانِيِّ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ. It's not your wishful thinking, O Muslims, nor the wishful thinking of Christians and Jews. The one who does evil, he will be punished. مَنْ يَعْمَلْ يُجْزَ بِهِ. So you find Islam talking very nice about all the prophets. How many of them? 25 of the biblical prophets and 120,000 prophets. We don't badmouth any of them. We respect the books of the Bible, the Torah and the Injil. And we tell the people those are books of wisdom and guidance. It's in the Quran. So the Muslims, they are not racist. They are not prejudiced based on origin or nationality or sex or gender or religion. And Islam, one of the ideals, is the freedom of conscience, the freedom of speech, the freedom of expression. You find this in all the ayahs and the Quran which address these issues, and very clear. In Surah Al-Baqarah we read, لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي. In another ayah, فمن شاء فليؤمن ومن شاء فليكفر. It's the freedom of belief, freedom of conscience, the freedom of, this is guaranteed by the Quran and the Hadith. As a matter of fact, you can see the ideals of Islam by what we call maqasid al-sharia, the ultimate goal of the deen, of the religion. In Islam, maqasid al-sharia, the ultimate goal is preserving life, preserving deen as a compass to guide you in this life, preserving life, and preserving your mind and the thinking faculty, the brain, and also preserving the family and the pedigree, and preserving your human rights. Al-ard, all of these five, six of them, maqasid al-sharia, it's to protect your life, to protect your compass, guiding system, to protect your mind and brain, to protect your family, ancestry, and your offsprings, to protect the environment. And the worst punishment in Islam for those who terrorize and spoil the environment and spoil the earth. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us to take good care of the earth. فَإِنَّهَا بِكُمْ بَرَّ. It's been good to you, like a mother. So we should not litter, we should not spoil, we should not deal with any nuclear stuff which can damage the earth for thousands of years, and there's no way to clean it. That's a serious problem, and I hope all humanity will be guided to abolish and abandon dealing with nuclear material. And may Allah bless you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.